So I'm Monica, and you would see Monika Chawla and Monika Rathi, and that's probably because of the name change after marriage. But both of that is the same person, that's me. As Puneet rightly said, right, that people have already won bids. We have seen right from, I remember 5-6 years ago, the tariffs were in the range of 12 rupees, and today they are down to like 2.44. So there is a lot of pressure on the entire industry. And I'm going to specifically talk about the pressure that the EPC players feel, not just because of the tariff reduction, but also because of the increase in the size of the plants, right? The average size of a plant earlier was probably in the range of 2 to 5 megawatts, which has gone to almost 100 megawatt at least in 2017. So what are some of the implications that we have because of these trends is something that I will cover through my presentation. And the most critical aspect that I want you all to go with today is the fact that reduction in tariff doesn't mean that we are allowed to cut corners, right? All of us talk about optimization in the entire plant. All of us talk about how do we value engineer the plant. But then we also need to ensure that the plant lasts for 25 years, irrespective of whatever we do, right? And I'm not going to focus on modules. I'm pretty confident that modules is something that we would cover as a part of the entire two-day session. So modules, if I keep away, what are some of the things that we need to be watchful for when we do value engineering in the solar plant design? And last but not the least, I'll conclude with a quick study of a 260 megawatt peak plant that Mahindra Susten had commissioned. It was commissioned in Feb of this year. That is the largest third-party EPC plant in India as of now. So a very quick animation is what I would like to play in terms of how that entire plant planned out. So if you look at how the industry has been moving, and I don't think I need to talk about these two graphs. They have been spoken about over and over again. But then what does this mean in terms of the requirements that we have as an EPC player? One, cost becomes imperative. Any guesses on the BOS cost numbers that you guys have heard in the market or expectations? I'm sure there are a lot of developers here. 1.35 is still high. Less than one is the expectation that people have. We have not hit it, but yes. Right? Anything else? Now, 1 to 1.35 is a big number that we need to bridge, right? There's almost a 35 lakhs per megawatt peak that needs to be bridged. So yes, there is a lot of cost pressure. Expectations are there. Reality is somewhere here, right? So how do we go about doing it? I would talk about few of the value engineering ideas that at least Mahindra Susten is looking at to ensure that we meet those kind of cost numbers. Turnaround times. Rams, 250 megawatt peak project. Kadapa, 250 megawatt peak project. 250 megawatt AC project, not even peak, right? The AC-DC ratios that we are talking about are in the range of 1.4 as on date, right? 1.35, 1.4, which would mean that this 250 megawatt AC would entitle to be 350 megawatt peak project. And what are the timelines that we are talking about? So for Kadapa, we get only about, the developer gets only about 13 months from the PPA signing date for a 350 megawatt AC project, DC project. For Rams, we get about 18 months, but then there are advantages in terms of faster commissioning. So of course, everybody, whether it is Mahindra Susten who has won a 250 megawatt or Soul Energy, everybody is looking at how do we do this project faster and faster. So the second pressure that as an EPC player we have is how do we do the same project in much faster duration. Reliability and durability. I have an anecdote that I'll show you from one of the plants where there was a storm that recently happened. And you will see for yourself what happened there, right? I don't think any one of us want to be in that kind of a situation. Yes, 2.44 is a reality, but we cannot be cutting corners on structural design. And that is the major one that I think I want to speak about, right? Whether we go with fixed tilt system or whether we go with tracker system, that is something I will leave as a choice to the developers, because we do see varying opinion as on date. Earlier, when the industry had completely moved toward tracker, right? Last year, if you see, the number of tracker projects that were installed in India is by far the largest in the entire 5-6 years of solar history in India, right? We have seen 106 megawatt of next tracker project being installed. Arctic has done pretty well in terms of installations. Mahindra Susten itself, we have a portfolio of about 400 megawatt of projects for tracker. But if you speak to the developers today, everybody is counting every single penny. So the advantages that we used to see with tracker in terms of 20-25% extra gain is becoming a challenge for the developer, because he wants to reduce his upfront capex cost. So whether it is fixed tilt or tracker, that's a choice that we would leave to the developers, but it is very, very critical that the structure is designed for that 25 years. And last but not the least, one of the fastest way to make revenue would be, how do we commission these plants faster? A 350 megawatt project, I don't want to wait till the end to actually commission this plant. I might have to divide it into clusters, and it could be a 50 megawatt, 100 megawatt, the number is debatable, but a smaller plot size, which I'm able to churn out much faster, commission much faster, specifically in bids where we get benefits of early commissioning, right? So both Kadapa and Rums, you do get benefit of early commissioning. So that's something that an EPC player would have to do. Coming to the design objectives, as I said, value engineering is something which is of critical interest for all of us. But how do we value engineer? Keeping safety in mind, durability in mind, and how do the same value engineered product gives me the faster execution? So from a durability perspective, there is a lot of analysis that the teams are doing today, whether it is owners, engineers, or whether it is an EPC player, in terms of ensuring that all your STAD results, all the FEA that you do on the plant, they're all 100% right for your design. Because you, specifically in the structural design, and I want to specifically go here on this page, there's a lot of debate that happens around the factors K1, K2, and K3. Which there's a little bit of unclarity in not so much clear in the IS codes, because it gives you the K1, K2, K3 values for a building. The conservative developers would want each one of this to be one, right? Which increases your tonnage. So your tonnage for a fixed tilt system would be in the range of about 36-37 tons if we have to go with a K1, K2, K3 one as one factor. Vis-a-vis, if we move to K1 as 1, K2 as 0.97 if it's a class A wind zone, and K3 as 1, I am able to reduce the tonnage from 36 to about 31, 32. And you would hear different people telling you a different number. There are people who talk about 29 tons as well. Now, what's the benefit that I'm getting? I am saving almost 4 to 5 tons, which is based on the commodity pricing that I have today, which is 75,000 rupees per ton, I am saving approximately 3.5 lakhs per megawatt peak, right? So everybody wants to do it. The onus is on the EPC player to ensure that when I save this cost of 3.5 or 4 lakhs, I am not disturbing the fact that the values that I've chosen for the structural analysis is as per the terrain and as per the wind zone of that particular site. Because same K1, K2, K3 values are not applicable if I move from, let's say, Rajasthan to Ghani to Kadapa, right? The numbers do change. So that becomes very critical. From a faster execution perspective, module earthing is something that I think we play a major role in terms of having those star washers to ensure that the module gets earthed by those star washers rather than putting up those strips that we used to do earlier. The second big piece after the structure comes out to be your inverter. There's a lot of debate, again, outdoor inverter versus indoor inverter, 1000 volt versus 1500 volt system. 1000 versus 1500 volt system, again, there are claims that we are able to save about, and I don't want to put a number, but there are claims that we do save a lot of power, a lot of cost by going on to a 1500 volt system. My answer as on date is no. 1000 versus 1500 volt system, because in 1500 volt we do not have that volumes in India. Most of the inverters which are available today are imported. I am not actually able to save money. So amount of saving that I would have done because my structure got optimized, because my cable got optimized, because my entire cluster size increased from a 4 megawatt to a 6.8 megawatt or a 10 megawatt actually gets defeated because my inverter cost nullifies that impact. So 1000 volt versus 1500 volt, as on date, we see almost similar pricing. Going forward, when the 1500 volt system value chain increases, the volume increases, yes, 1500 volt system might become cheaper. And the cost would become cheap only because of two factors. One, if we see reduction in the combiner box prices. Two, if we see reduction in the inverter prices. And both of those are not there today for the 1500 volt system. The second advantage that you would get, and it's not 1000 or 1500, but it is in outdoor versus indoor inverters. I think outdoor inverters do make quite a bit of sense today because it increases your speed of work at site, right? We could again debate between string versus central inverter, right? But if I talk about central inverter, yes, with an outdoor skid, it is much faster to do the installation in the same speed as we would want for these projects. If we end up using a higher capacity indoor inverter, so ABB has a 1.7 megawatt, I am able to actually increase my cluster size from 4 to 6.8. I think the entire industry is looking at this change in a very positive manner, because with a 6.8 megawatt cluster size and a 5-winding transformer, we are able to actually reduce the cost significantly, because the entire thing, I mean, I've reduced my number of inverters, I've reduced the number of containers, I've reduced the cable costs. In fact, cable costs do increase a little bit because my length has increased. But all the associated accessories I've reduced, my breakers have reduced. From a AC side, the number of equipments, the isolators have reduced, and hence it helps me improve the total efficiency of the plant. Now, what is most critical in a container is that it should be, the design should be approved by an inverter supplier, right? So as a developer, just don't go with whatever container comes your way. Because if the ventilation has not been properly designed, the inverters may actually end up heating up and you would see issues. There was a recent case, and I'm sure a lot of people are aware of it, so I don't need to speak about it. Last piece that I want to talk about on the design part is the fact that we are moving away from so-called the ideal solar power plant to a plant which meets its functional requirement. And when I said so, what I mean is we are used to using WBM roads on our plants, and we need to move away to Murram, right? That is one industry change that will probably help us meet that 2.44 figure. Drainage. Again, a concept, there are developers who are very, very pertinent about the fact that we want RCC or we want this kind of a trapezoidal design or stone pitch. But I think in areas where it is possible, where we don't have a black cotton soil, it is very, very critical for us to move away to earthen drains, because that is what is going to help us reduce the costs. So from a design perspective, I would say for all your civil work, whether it is your foundation, roads or drains, no frills, because these are basic functional requirements that can be met by a functional Murram road or by a functional earthen drain as well. I don't need the same standards and design that I had, which was when my tariff was pretty high. Here is an example that I said earlier that I'll share. There was a heavy sandstorm, 72 kilometer per hour. So this is still within the design speed, right? And one of the plants, 20 megawatt, there were only 8 modules broken. You can see there was some dust inside one of the control rooms and few wires which were handled. This is our own project, by the way. So this 20 megawatt project was done by Mahindra Susten for Fun Roche. And look at some of the other projects that were nearby. Another 2 megawatt plant, 2,500 modules damaged. So 20 megawatt versus 2 megawatt, 8 modules versus 2,500 is what I'm talking about. Second one, you can see the entire structure itself broken. Transmission pole has come out. The tower has got, you can see it tilted there, right? Now, I'm not talking about these examples to showcase one good over the other. Yes. Seismic design is done on them to a particular level
as per the IS code. Yes, as per the norm, whatever the IS code asks for, that is done. But beyond that, of course, it would be all over. But this is within the design limits.
So the purpose of showing that slide was not to say that our plant is better than others. The purpose of that slide was for all of us to remember that we may be designing a plant which is functional today, but if there is a one incident like this, which is not so-called normal, right? But yes, it is still within the design speed limits. The entire plant might be down, right? So all those numbers like 2.44 and 2.62 are not gonna be significant if I have a damage like this. And this is something which we all need to be cognizant of, whether I talk about an EPC player or a developer. So that is something that puts a challenge on to us to ensure that we don't get drifted by these numbers and start not looking at quality. That becomes very, very critical for us. Another thing from a faster turnaround perspective that I think we should be looking at is something called as cluster first offs, wherein the first design, whether it is a 4 megawatt or a 6.8 megawatt cluster, you have the entire first design ready within the first 40 to 45 days. And this model cluster can be used not only for training your contractors, but also for getting a confirmed approval from the developer or from the owner's engineer saying that, yes, this is good to go. This is the expectation that I have of this plant. And then you replicate. And this becomes very critical, specifically if you are talking about a bigger megawatt project, right? 100 megawatt and above. So a cluster of first up helps you benchmark and helps you meet those expectations that you have for the developer. In terms of quality control, another aspect that we, Mahindra Susten as an EPC player, are very, very mindful of, we start doing a lot of these controls right from doing the installations. So you would see that EL testing is done on all the modules. We do have our own PV test labs, which can be taken to the sites where we can do flash test also on the modules. This helps us de-risk this activity, because if there are any damages on the module or the module capacity is not within the limits that we would have asked for, you could get for replacements upfront. Similarly, if you do the entire string health monitoring check upfront, the advantage that you get is that when you are going for commissioning, you are not stuck there because few of your tables are not working the way you want them to. So a lot of these tests, if you bring upfront, and I've not highlighted here, we do a lot of tests on HT panel, we do a lot of tests on transformers, inverters, to ensure that when we are there for commissioning, we are 100% ready. So I like to show an example of a SoftBank project that we just completed. Can we have the volume up? So this is the labor colony, all containerized so that you don't have any RCC rooms. Training area for all contractors. Look at some of the numbers, they are way above the industry standard. Just because it was a much bigger plant and you need that kind of a pace. Some of the engagement initiatives, because this helps you manage the ROW issues as well. Not just the labors, but the community around you. We did use a specific trenching machine here for doing the trenching. You saw that in the previous page. This is all containerized solution. So no RCC for the inverter rooms or prefab rooms for inverter as well. Look at the average number of labors that we have had at site. 1200 on this plant during the peak period. All the HT panels were also on skid, so you saw those steel pipe foundations that were there for the HT panel. And this is the final picture of the plant. That's right. So to sum it up all, I think the video that I showed you, all the value engineered ideas that I was talking about, we have utilized it in that plant. And it helped us not only do faster commissioning, but it also helped us commission much fast, which means that I was able to, I think within 16 hours, we commissioned almost 132 megawatts, which is a good enough number because all of this was already pre-tested, pre-commissioned. Right, so that helps you bring up the speed that you would want from an EPC player. So I would like to conclude by saying that yes, there's a lot of challenge in terms of reducing the cost, but not at the cost of quality. So we do want to value engineer our products, but want to keep the safety and reliability of the plant as one of the highest goal for ourselves. Of course, a lot of our ideas and designs have to be around faster turnaround for these plants, which would entail how do we go away from eliminating complete civil work, right? Obviously, foundations, you would have to do pile foundations. So a little bit of foundation work you would have to do. But other than that, no RCC rooms, no inverter rooms, or even control rooms for that matter, which are RCC in nature, because that would reduce your speeds. All quality checks to be done prior to commissioning, maybe at the factory level as well, as and when it is needed, specifically on the module side. And of course, if you have so many number of people employed at site, safety of those employees become critical, right? Because there are unskilled and skilled labors and a lot of labors which are taken from around that area. So it becomes critical to ensure that there is a tighter project management team which is available to do this kind of projects.